So the very sort of the earliest rave I remember was, I suppose it was more sort of acid house. What had actually come from, I suppose, like proper house music. And I'd say, yeah, it was definitely acid house parties where it sort of went on and became the rave sound. Like acid house was very much like a sort of kick drum, TB-303, 808 drum machine. And it was sort of just sort of very them sort of aqua, the acid sounds. I suppose like for me, Prodigy, sort of way before things like Charlie Says, they were coming along where they were sort of changing it up, where the sort of acid house sound was like very kick drum orientated. Also, and it was like, right, it must have been because of the birth of the sampler when I think about it. So the sampler allowed people to start sampling breakbeats from old records, catching little vocals, and then that sort of started evolving with this early acid house sound.
The XL recordings era suddenly exploded with Prodigy, SL2, and people like that. And it just sort of, I always sort of felt myself being drawn towards the rainy side of everything.
BPM Smoking at the United Dance Organisation. I'm here with Dougal on the far right and Ixie, drop the H, Ixie on the left, all right?
So we started off, when I started BPM, it was at 132. And when Prodigy came along with 132 BPM, we were like, oh my God, this is insane, it's so fast.
I started off, my first record was at 140 something BPM. And now we're on 170, everyone always says 170.
Definitely the raves were very noisy in an incredible way. If you listen back to the old videos, it's the whistles and the horns just overtake the sound of the, you know, the sound system.
I do remember that. You hired like some nightmare studio down in Portsmouth, and I went all the way down there, and we had a good idea, but then like, if you didn't have somebody who really knew what they were doing in the studio making music, it was a battle, and I just remember it was really hard work. But we got there, and the computer kept crashing, and then you get the idea, and then it'd all disappear. It was more of a band studio.
Yeah.
Back then, one of the hardest things to do was, unless you had all your own equipment, which at the time we didn't, was get into a studio that understood dance music.
Disc one is most probably High Love. It's just the piano and vocal for me. It, when I listen to it now, it still sounds as strong as it did then.
My favourite track, I think, would be JDS High Love. Just love it. It's one of them tracks, it's attached to massive memories for me as well. Being, I can remember where I was in the club the first time I heard it, then wanting to source out the track, getting a copy of it.
As we go into CD2, it'll be things like, I suppose, your Heart of Gold, your Pretty Green Eyes, just because they mean so much to the beginning of that music for me. And maybe without them tracks happening, I don't know if Happy Hardcore would have ever had the explosion it did. I remember that Heart of Gold used to get played most probably 5-6 times in a night, and people still weren't bored of it.
Favorite track on CD2 is Force and Styles featuring Junior, Pretty Green Eyes. Again, it holds massive memories for me, which I think is really important with music. Really great friends of mine, so we always spent a lot of time together when they produced and wrote that song. Sadly, Junior is no longer with us as well, so it's even more poignant whenever we play it.
CD3 would be, I suppose I loved getting, that was the birth of like me and Gamma working together. So anything from me and Gamma sort of is very special to me as well, because that was like a whole new era of like of the happy hardcore, but where it sort of developed and moved on. So I think Guitar Hero is one of my favourites with Gamma.